Okay, we're going to get started. All right, well, good evening, everyone. It's great to see everybody. Welcome and thank you for being here. I'm Tom Inglesby. I'm the director of the Center for Health Security at Johns Hopkins. And we're very excited to be having this discussion around realizing the benefits and managing the risks of the intersection of AI and biotechnology. And I have an amazing group of people to my left who I will introduce in a moment, but just to tell you the plan for the evening is that I will moderate this discussion until about 5:45, at which point I will invite questions from the audience, and we'll continue to about 6 o'clock, and then we will go downstairs for a reception. Hopefully all of you can stay for a little bit of the reception, which will go from 6 to 7. So with that, now let me turn to introduce our panelists for this discussion. And immediately on my left is Ms. Helena Fu, who is director in the Office of Critical and Emerging Technology at the Department of Energy. And she previously served as director for technology and national security at the White House NSC. To her left is Dr. Shankar Sundaram, who is the senior director for global health security and biodefense at the NSC. And was previously the director for the Center for Bioengineering at the Lawrence Livermore National Lab, where he led the laboratory's bioengineering strategy and technology development. To his left is Dr. Michelle Rozo, who is the vice chair for the National Security Commission on Emerging Biotechnology. She is also VP of Technology at In-Q-Tel and previously served as director of technology and national security at the US NSC. And to her left is Ms. Tejal Patwardhan, who is a technical staff lead on the preparedness team at OpenAI. And at OpenAI, she has contributed to their effort to build an early warning system for large language model-aided biological threats. So thank you all so much for being here for this discussion. Welcome to all of you, a really distinguished group of experts on these issues. And so for this discussion, we want to focus on the benefits and risks of AI and biotechnology with a particular focus on what Congress should be considering regarding, first, the AI executive order that was issued in the fall of 2023, and on suggestions from panelists regarding the potential Senate AI framework. There are many staffers in this audience, and we're very interested in trying to provide your advice or suggestions as they do their work, and more broadly on Congress's role around AI and bio issues generally. So that's what we hope to do in the time that we have together. And so let me just start with a question to all of you. I want to hear all of your reactions to this. What do you believe are the potential greatest benefits from this intersection between AI and biotechnology? And what do you think are the greatest risks that we need to tend to as we are driving forward to reach those benefits? And we'll just go down the line and start with you, Helena.
Thanks so much. And thanks so much for having me here. I'm really pleased to be joining this all-star panel. I also note that I am representing one of the agencies that is tasked to do many, many things mm-hmm. as part of the AI executive order. And one thing that I think just in terms of what we are planning to do, DOE is a really special agency, as you know. It has energy in its name, but it really spans both open and closed, and really, really deep partnerships with industry on applied energy, but also beyond, right, through things like our exascale computing program. And so, you know, when I think about AI and bio, and I think about the vast multidisciplinary, you know, I have even a lab representative right next to me here, and some here as well. You know, we have AI expertise at the labs, but we also have really deep multidisciplinary expertise that can really be brought to bear on these really, really important problem sets. And so we're thinking very much about how we can find the balance of the opportunity and the risk. And I think, you know, where we sit in the innovation ecosystem on both open scientific discovery and also our national security mandate really, I think, gives us a very unique perspective to see where that balance lies, both in terms of, you know, opportunities for creating faster and more effective countermeasures, treatments, but also, you know, new sources of bioenergy and biotechnology. And so these are things that we think about a lot. There are many more in this room that are more well-versed in this than I, but I think it's absolutely a big part of what we hope to be doing, both in terms of promoting innovation. You know, the EO tasks us with developing foundation models useful for science, energy, and security. Those are really, really big things. It also tasks us with safe and secure AI, working with commerce, working with other colleagues in the interagency to evaluate open source models and to conduct red teaming around CBRN. And so these are really, really big things, and we really very much look forward to working with folks in this room and also in the interagency on them.
Thanks so much. Shankar.
Gosh, these are really exciting times. From my perspective, I was trained as an engineer and came into biology more or less as an accident. And an engineer is trained to really kind of break down things and build them back better and try to understand how things work. And I cannot imagine if somebody who was, you know, toiling in this field two or three decades ago, if they came across and saw the kinds of capabilities that are there today, how they would react. And so I think it's really a sort of an inflection point or a transformative moment in time in terms of technologies and their convergence. And I think, you know, folks here recognize the AI part of it, but I also want to give a shout out to the biotechnologists and, you know, the impactful work that they have done in being able to read biology at scale, but now being able to write biology at scale. All of the engineers and the automation scientists who have developed those high throughput techniques to generate the data that can train these models, to, you know, make all of those wearable sensors and everything else that you're using to kind of generate data even as you walk around. And automation leading up to the promise of, you know, cloud labs and all of that. So I think the way that these three things come together are going to be transformative in pretty much almost every aspect of our preparedness from both the pandemics as well as the biosecurity, not just in the health sector, which I think everybody appreciates, from surveillance to diagnostics to countermeasures, but also in other aspects, everything from PPEs, novel materials designs, or pharmaceutical interventions in terms of a risk-based analysis to guide our posture in terms of trying to, in a measured fashion, respond to a threat. So I think it's going to be transformative across all sectors of biopreparedness, and acknowledging all of that promise at the same time, unfortunately, there are bad actors in the world. And we've got to make sure that we are preventing them from misusing any of this technology by whatever means that we can take, which I'm sure will be a subject of this discussion. And really, I think that there is definitely a way forward in terms of us promoting or walking down the path of responsible innovation. Not sacrificing anything on the innovation side, but doing that in a safe and secure fashion.
Great. I'm going to turn to Michelle.
Sure. Thank you, Tom. And thank you for the invitation to be here. I'm really excited to share some of the work that we're undertaking at the National Security Commission on emerging biotech, where we are formulating policies to ensure that the United States can reap the enormous potential benefits of biotech. And as this audience is well aware, these benefits are enormous and far-reaching. It's not just medicine and pharmaceuticals, but of course has the potential to take, you know, entire classes of disease off the table, but also have implications for agriculture and food security and energy and industry, creating new supply chains with renewable, sustainable sources of materials or chemicals that we now rely on from foreign sources or through feedstocks like petroleum. As well as defense and national security capabilities that can help protect our ability to defend ourselves in the United States as well as our forces abroad. So the potential benefits are enormous, but I will say we are not yet at the ChatGPT moment for this technology. Although advances are happening every day, we are not yet able to engineer biology in the way that we might want to. And it's because biology is complex. We don't yet know all of the ins and outs. And I believe that artificial intelligence and the use of machine learning tools applied to bio are really going to be what unlocks all of these potential benefits. So, you know, this intersection is really critical. And one of the risks that we are examining at the Commission is the risk that we don't reach this inflection point at the convergence of AI and biotech before an adversary does, particularly an adversary that has different ethics, different beliefs than we do, and that may seek to use those technologies in ways that differ from ways that we would. And so we are contemplating policies that would address both us reaching those opportunities and, again, doing so quicker than others may.
Great, thanks. Tejal.
Great, thanks so much, Tom, for having us here. At OpenAI, we're very excited about the potential for AI to supercharge innovation and productivity across domains, including in biology. But like any technology, it does not come without its risks, and that's part of why our team preparedness was founded, was to help make sure we can mitigate these potential downsides of this technology while still achieving the upside. And two points I might talk about here. The first is we're thinking a lot about how to operationalize a process for evaluating and tracking and mitigating risks related to biological misuse of our models, and so put out a preparedness framework in December of last year that I encourage folks to read and give feedback on as we try to internalize processes to make sure that we are deploying and developing our own models safely. And then second is we see the field of research in terms of how we actually measure what our models can do as very nascent, and so have been leading some efforts in putting out raw data, putting out our actual evaluations of our models. So have a blog post that we published last week where we measured sort of the potential of our models to be used for biological misuse, and are hoping that others in the field continue to publish this sort of research so we can drive assessment of the risks with data rather than, you know, hypotheticals of what might be possible.
Great, and let me just commend you for that report that I think many in the audience have read and have been thinking about. I'll just add to the list of benefits, I think there's already been mentioned, but I think we're particularly excited about the potential for AI to drive medical countermeasure development broadly defined, whether it's medicines, therapeutics, diagnostics, and to drive potentially early detection strategies, early signals, whether it's through surveillance or through patterns in the environment. So enormous potential there. I think on our side, my colleagues and I are particularly focused looking ahead, not at the moment, on the risks around the potential for AI-driven biotechnology to either create new biological variants with pandemic potential and the importance of scanning for that and preventing that, or to simplify or enable the creation or resurrection, I should say, of extinct viruses that had pandemic potential. So I think there is a hierarchy of potential dangers, which maybe we'll talk more about, and I think some are smaller, some are larger, but also an enormous benefit which we have to drive for. So excited to talk more about that. In that vein, just thinking about in the last year, many of the large language model companies, including yours, Tejal, I think had showed great leadership in the voluntary commitments that they made at the White House and beyond to do some of the things that you're now doing and talking about. And then we had the executive order that came out. What do you all think we should be doing now beyond the voluntary principles or to implement effectively the executive order around AI? What are some of the priorities there beyond what you've already done, what you've seen? Anyone, so, all of you, yeah.
I'll take a first crack at it because I see several of my colleagues who are toiling at it.
Great.
So, a couple of things. One is, I think, in terms of the voluntary guidance and measures taken on the LLM side, I think that needs to be sort of broadly encouraged and adopted across other entities that are developing AI-based tools in the AI bio space. But also, additionally, importantly, we're focusing on the implementation of the AI executive order. So to get the regulatory framework and the policy guidance in place across departments and agencies so that we can, kind of very rationally build a safe framework for the development of these technologies that allows our private companies to flourish, but at the same time safeguards against their misuse.
Great.
Michelle?
Yeah, I'll jump in, and it gives me the opportunity to plug some work that we just released from the commission. So we are right now sourcing ideas in service of answering that question that you asked, Tom. And staff put out a series of white papers, I have some copies here, on the intersection of AI and bio. We released them on our website. I encourage everyone to check that out. It's at biotech.senate.gov. And I also have a few staff members here with me tonight. Can you guys raise your hands? They have a couple other copies as well. We present in the fourth of the four white papers ideas that can address both the benefits and the risks of what we're seeing at the intersection of AI and bio. These are meant to start a conversation. We're looking for input. We're looking for things we may have missed or ways to evolve these ideas as we shape them into formal policy recommendations that we intend to release in the coming months. So I'll share kind of a high level of the three buckets that we're looking at, but again, really encourage input from this community and hope we can continue to talk and shape these concepts. The three areas that we're contemplating, the first is promoting innovation. So, you know, in line with some of the conversations we've had thus far, we're looking at how we might support high-performance computing for biotech, looking at the creation and support for new standardized biological data sets that can help drive the evolution of these models. We're looking at creating potentially public-private partnerships that might be able to support AI and bioconvergence, sort of like a sandbox concept, looking at some of the capabilities that some of my colleagues on stage have in their agencies, what might be utilized here. Looking at international consortium for potential for evolving ethical frameworks. So all of that is detailed as potential options in our sort of promote innovation bucket. The second bucket looks at managing risk, and this could be risk at the level of the models themselves. So what guardrails, what sort of red teaming might be necessary. We're also looking at the digital to physical transition. Designs are only dangerous when they are made, right? And so how can we monitor that? And then finally, we're looking at future risks. How can we continue to look at and develop policy options that are nimble, that evolves alongside the technology? And so we're looking at red teaming and areas like global competitive analyses that allow us to measure where we are vis-a-vis our strategic competitors in these critical technologies. So again, still in the idea phase, but look forward to shaping them into formal recommendations.
Thank you. Tejal?
Yeah, first just wanted to thank everyone for, I think there's been renewed interest in, you know, policy research and technical research in this field, which is very needed. So thank you everyone who has been working on that. Maybe just on the research side, I think there's still a lack of clarity in the field as to really what the data says about misuse risks related to biological threats from LLMs. And I think more work is needed both on automated evaluations of models, so making sure we're actually measuring what the full extent of model capabilities are now and where they might be in the future and how we can prepare ourselves based on what forecasts might look like. And then similarly, human-driven evals, actually looking, you know, bringing experts into a room and having them red team, not just, you know, without a baseline, but comparing what model capabilities might look like compared to the internet or a baseline of existing resources that experts might have. I think some of the methodology here is early and emerging, and there's still a lot of work to be done. So I hope that more folks in industry and academia and in government and civil society continue to publish this work and collaborate to make our methods as scientifically sound as possible.
Great. Helene?
I just want to riff off a little bit of Michelle's thoughts over here, because I think we at DOE are really thinking about all of these things. So promoting innovation, you know, the data sets that are really going to be needed. I think one of the really exciting things at DOE through our BRAVE program, which is our program for foundational science in biopreparedness and response, one of the things that we are working on is a new synthetic data set that will serve as a training benchmark for AI models that will detect cancer and other diseases. I think that's really exciting. On the risk side, I mentioned earlier that we have a responsibility as part of the AI executive order to be doing red teaming and model evaluations. That is something that is already underway. We have a multi-lab team that's already engaged in this effort, especially around nuclear, but I think many of the things that we are learning in this space are going to be very applicable for other types of red teaming. And so we look forward to working with others on this and are already in discussion with other colleagues in the interagency. And then I think important, you know, really looking towards the future, right? Because I think one thing that DOE does uniquely well is to develop mission work towards a specific mission set and develop a capability for that mission set in cooperation with our interagency partners and being driven by the needs of our interagency partners like DOD and other members of the IC. And so, you know, just looking at what a future capability needs to look at, doing the kind of competitive analysis that our labs are already also engaged in now, but kind of bringing that to other fields in critical emerging technology is going to be really important.
Great. Well, just following up on one of the themes that I think came from, I think, everyone's comments, is the importance of developing clear guidance around red teaming, evaluations. I think it was mentioned in the commission's report, the importance of developing assessment approaches, and Tejal mentioned it. I think everybody mentioned it a bit. And while those things are beginning and are happening in different ways, there are some organizations which are developing some expertise around that. Still, at this point, it seems like it's up to every company to decide what to red team, what to evaluate, how to do it, what to do with the evaluation. Can you all say more about what we should be driving towards in terms of what's the vision of success here with red teaming and evaluations? Should this all be a voluntary enterprise? Should there be some standards? We know NIST is developing guidance by the summertime, which is going to be so important. What do we do with that guidance? How do we think about that? Anyone?
Oh. Yeah. Maybe, I mean, because we're in the thick of it.
Yeah, you're in the thick of it, so yeah.
I think that the things that we are learning, and as you say, it does feel like every time we do this, we are learning new things, and mm-hmm. it does feel very manual at times. And so I think that's obviously not a sustainable, you know, solution in the long term. We're going to need to develop other systems to do this at scale. And that is something that we are actively thinking through, that we will need to work very closely with NIST on how to do this in a sustainable fashion. Obviously, the AI Safety Institute and Consortia mm-hmm. is a center of gravity. There are other centers of gravity that are being developed in other countries, too. We just met with the UK earlier today. I think they're also up to quite a lot of exciting things. So, I mean, there's a lot to do in this space. As you say, there's a lot of different efforts. But I do think that they seem to be coalescing. But I'm going to look down the road to see if others have a different view.
Yeah, any thoughts on red teaming and evaluations? What should this look like a year from now? Where should we be driving towards?
We should be driving towards safe and secure AI bio tools. But again, I'm speaking from the National Security Council with colleagues from OSTP and others, and we want to kind of set policy, but the policy is really informed by science, right? And the safety science is still a nascent field. I think from at least some of our perspectives, we are doing the best that we can, querying the models the way I think Tejal and I were talking earlier, and about, you know, looking as from an expert's point of view and seeing what they would ask, but that's not necessarily the total sum of the risk. And so ultimately, you know, we've got to figure out how, and we've tackled this in, you know, level of uncertainty in other fields before. So the question here is, how do we understand and sort of do the capability elicitation, as people talk about, but ultimately a challenge for me would be, like, you know, can you think about intent, right? You know, can I have these kinds of frameworks be able to respond to intent?
Yeah, so, I will just say I agree with that comment, and sort of one of the principles that we're carrying forward as we shape our ideas into recommendations is this sort of looking at the scenario, at the intent of an actor that may misuse a tool, and recognizing that a one-size-fits-all approach, you know, doesn't work very well here, where there are inherent differences in risk in different models and different data sets. You know, there's a large difference in what you see in large language models trained on human language, you know, like OpenAI, and what we see in biodesign tools, which are trained on biological information. And so we need to make sure that policies can be flexible to recognize that you know, the models are different, the biorisks are different, and take into account intent and scenarios and how bad actors may misuse different tools in different ways.
Tejal, anything else you wanted to say about this topic?
just one point from a research perspective is, as we all know, this technology changes very quickly. I might remind you all, just over a year ago, ChatGPT was a low-key research preview that wasn't really expected to be used widely. And the use cases that we're seeing for these models, as well as their capabilities, are likely to change rapidly. And it's sort of hard to predict. And so it'll be very important for the research community to sort of have a finger on the pulse of where are our models today, where will they be tomorrow, and make sure we're very grounded in the actual science.
And I'll add that the things like the protein language models are where ChatGPT-3 was maybe a year and a half ago, so they're coming too.
Yeah, on that topic of LLMs and BDTs, do you all have anything else you'd like to say about the kind of the coming together of those kinds of technologies? There's the examples of, I think, Microsoft using ChatGPT. There are others that are either planned or to be announced. What is that bridging between the two categories of AI tools? What does that imply? What should we be thinking about in terms of both benefit and risk?
I can jump in with something here. I think, you know, when we've been talking to an extensive amount of companies, and we're really focusing a lot on the BDT side of this, yeah, and biotech companies that are leveraging AI tools and large language models trained on biological data sets. Right now, these are by and large very computationally heavy, maybe user unfriendly is a nice way to put it, tools. They're not like ChatGPT, right? If anyone has tried to use them, they're at the level of computer code. So it's not as simple as going online and typing in a query. They're still very manual. Requires lots of computer expertise and biological expertise to leverage these tools. And they're also built on data sets that are not nearly as large as the LLMs trained on human language. So there's a lot of potential for these tools to advance and to grow. It's a good time to be having these conversations, and things that we are talking to these developers about are looking to understand the types of benefits and capabilities they're looking to drive with their models. And what types of mitigations and risk mitigation tools might be able to be put in place that would guard against misuse, but also, you know, continue to preserve their ability to leverage these tools for the benefits that they're trying to see out of them. And so that's been a productive line of inquiry for the commission and sort of how we're thinking about developing policy recommendations before some of the risks that you talked about earlier, Tom, I think are realized.
I would just add here, you know, I think our labs are already doing some of this work, and they're looking at, you know, as you say, sort of the language of biology to understand the evolution of virus, and they did that for COVID-19. I think it was really, really transformative in that way. I'm really interested, actually, for folks in the room, and I don't know where you're all coming from, but whether or not you've even heard of the program Guide, please raise your hand if you have. I know some of you do, but not actually as many as I would think, given this particular problem set. And so I think, you know, just kind of talking about how you manage these risks, one of the things that our labs are really able to do, because we work, again, across open and closed, is that we can understand where some of those risks might be and try to figure out how to, you know, toe the line between open, reproducible science and the risks that come when you release code to the world, right? And so for those of you who don't know, and I know those of you have heard about Guide, have heard about it ad nauseum, but for those who haven't, you know, and I'm going to butcher the story, but please come back after this. But, you know, when Omicron was emerging, DOD was very concerned about the impacts of what it might mean for their force. They came to DOE and the national labs to see what could be done about this. And, you know, to this point of computational capacity, DOE was able to use our own high-performance computing to be able to, in a matter of 3 weeks, come up with potential antivirals. And I think soon afterwards, going into clinical trial. Now, why haven't you heard of it? Because there were other mutations that appeared that overtook Omicron. And so what they did with DOD again in 2023 was be able to use that computational capacity to design future-proof antivirals. And I think what's really exciting about that is we were able to do that so quickly, saving quite a lot of time and energy. and that we were able to prove it out in the physical world. And I think that connectivity from what you're finding in models to whether or not it actually is a threat, you can only do that if you're able to then test it out experimentally. And so I think that's a really important piece that really is missing, I think, in some of the initial red teaming is you might find a risk, you might find something coming out of a model, but you also need to then show if it actually is posing a risk in some way, and we need a way to do that.
Hmm. Yeah, that raises a lot of questions in my mind, but it's good to be talking about it now before we actually move to that. I think one thing that I think you all both, you've raised, Michelle, you raised the importance of thinking about in silico to physical transition and what we can do to try and kind of mitigate risk there. And I think your report, your interim report, talks about codifying best practices around genome synthesis screening. Do you want to say a word about that? Because it seems like that's a big part of this, one of the tools we could use.
Sure. Yeah, it's something, again, we are contemplating. It's not a formal recommendation that we want to make at this time. But to the point earlier, as I think I described, right, designs are not inherently dangerous. It's taking actually generating those designs, making something physical out of that, where the risk is incurred. And so we are looking at options around that transition, and one of those is gene synthesis screening, which is being contemplated on the Hill right now for, you know, if that is an appropriate recommendation at this time and how that would be implemented. So we're asking companies, you know, how many of them already do this sort of screening, how they do their screening, what that looks like. And then as you think about artificial intelligence and those who may want to, again, misuse this in ways that it's unintended to evade screening, how you know, policies would be able to keep up with advances in those tools and how you might be able to screen for what is now an unknown.
Yeah, I think it's such an important conversation because I think what we've been hearing is that some of the tests of the system that we have now in place, the voluntary system of screening, have shown how porous the system is currently, and the idea of codifying it and bringing the industry up to a standard seems really important to us as well. So I'm glad that the commission's investigating that and having discussions with companies. It's exciting. Shankar, I was going to turn to you and ask you a little bit about how the implementation of the executive order is going. How there's a lot of work going across the agencies, very different assignments, very aggressive time scales. How's it going?
First off, if you have any detailed questions, we have Gopal in the back.
So okay.
Find him. but again, just to kind of zoom back out a bit, you know, if you take a systems view of the whole thing going from ideation, design generation to physical manifestation and release, and so you realize that the problem is really, you know, immense, but, you know, the solution also lies in the complexity in the sense that you want, you know, defense in depth. You want a layered defense. So you want to secure the AI models, but another choke point that you quickly realize is in translating those designs into biological molecules and organisms. And a key step that is common everywhere is you start with synthesizing DNA. And so that becomes a natural point for us to come in with additional controls. And our colleagues over in HHS released last year in October updated guidance on gene synthesis regulation. We're building on that, and currently the AIEO for, it's not an accidental accident that you have a specific section that's calling out not only the CBRN risk, but also gene synthesis, where we're going to go back and try to kind of understand and build a regulatory framework around this. The key part is that, you know, we want to make sure that we make it, we depart from just the voluntary adherence, which is giving you a patchwork of providers that may satisfy the screening requirements, and then we have to rely on the LLMs not finding folks that are not screening. So by being able to make sure that we have a science-based screening approach that is required to be adopted by all synthesis providers with federal grants, that's something that we're actively working towards.
It's great to know. So Tejal, just back to you and your comment a few moments ago about the importance of looking ahead and how this is a very dynamic field, more research is needed, thinking about the future. Can you give us any kind of foreshadowing about what is ahead in model development. I know it's probably not easy to forecast, but when people think about future LLMs, for example, what will become more powerful? What will we see that's different from today? Or what should we be expecting or anticipating?
Great question. I will caveat all of this with forecasting is a very difficult science, and we tend to be wrong a lot of the time. But I think there is a general hypothesis at the moment that capabilities may continue to increase, and that things like both language abilities as well as other multimodal abilities may continue to increase. And in terms of how to build effective forecasts, something that we've started to iterate on from our preparedness framework is how to evaluate models during training and before deployment. As you know, we conduct a lot of red teaming and evaluation on our models from a safety perspective before deployment, and sort of continuing to make sure we have even richer data and can be even more sure as the models get more capable will be very important because, as you know, if you don't measure something, then you might not be protecting against it. So making sure you have the right measures in place and are tracking the right things ahead of time will be very important. But who knows?
Okay. And Helena, could you say a little bit more about the testbed work that you are doing? That's kind of one, I think, area of a lot of interest in the community. And also how you all within DOE, as you talked about before, you have enormous computing power and many tool developers in the DOE and kingdom. How do you all do your own evaluations now that things aren't inadvertently going off the rails or risks aren't being created? How do you manage the potential enormous benefits with all that you have with potential risks?
So firstly, I would call it a DOE corner, not a kingdom. But I mean, frankly, I think the things that we do are really in aid of both our mission, but also the mission of our sponsors, right? And so their needs drive transformation and innovation in our own capabilities as we rise to meet the challenges that are laid ahead. We are thinking a lot about how we manage the risks. I think just going back to the guide program, I think one of the reasons why you probably haven't heard about it is because it hasn't been published. And one of the reasons why it hasn't been published is because there's been a lot of back and forth with the publisher about what code should be released. And, kind of this competing, how do we make data federally funded, data open? We have a very strong directive from the president to do that, right? Open science, and making it available to the community. As well as the very real concerns we have about biosecurity, right? We are thinking about that not only in bio, but across the domains where DOE is working. We have an S&T, a science and technology risk matrix that we already apply. It's not specific to AI, but I think we are doing a second relook to think about what AI capabilities will do to the matrix that we've developed to think about what we're funding, what we're releasing out into the open, what we're keeping behind the fence of the laboratory, and then the fence, the classified fence. And so I think, how are we managing that with a lot of effort? I think what helps is that it is already happening within the confines of one of our labs or several of our labs, and so we're able to do that as the first layer, but this question of how you balance the open and the close is something that has been time immemorial on all topics, right, related to security. It's not just AI. AI just brings a new layer to that whole conversation.
Great. Well, I'm going to now invite people to ask questions if you have them. Just come to one of the mics. I'll keep going if there aren't any questions, but please feel free to come and join the conversation. I guess one question I'd ask all of you is whether or not there are some misperceptions about what's going on in terms of development or governance or driving this technology that are out there that you'd like to clarify, or kind of messages for congressional staff that you think would be useful. Yeah, Shankar.
Knowing that, speaking from the administration perspective, I don't want to say anything about what we want the Congress to do, but I'm really excited to see that there are folks in Congress that are recognizing the criticality of this issue. And the fact is that I think there is unanimity more than you realize across all parts of the government, probably, to say that, okay, this is important to make sure that we stay at the forefront of innovation in this while we are balancing and addressing the security risks. And we're looking forward to kind of working with our colleagues across all parts of the government and the private sector and everywhere to engage in the fight to kind of make that happen.
Great. Well, I see two questions here. So I think you were here first. Maybe you could just introduce yourself so we know where you're coming from.
Sure. Joe Russell from MRI Global. I lead the bioinformatics team there. Great discussion. Appreciate it. My question is, you mentioned a choke point at the oligosynthesis stage of potential bad actors. I'm wondering what the government's thoughts are on another one being the data itself that the models are trained on. So there's large repositories of public data that presumably are going to be the main source of these models being trained, but a lot of that data is mislabeled. It's very poorly annotated. What are the thoughts on the government funding or the research community maybe expecting to see more funding for data curation and data generation simply for data's sake? Authentication all the way to a tube in a freezer of the genome that you're training on. That metadata being, I'll give an example. My team and I, we were putting together a genotype to phenotype model based on the feature space was CAMRs, degenerate CAMRs, and we applied that to human-hosted versus non-human-hosted flu. And there was one record that kept coming up, the model kept saying was a human isolated flu, when we knew, per our metadata labeling, that it was supposed to be a bird flu. But we were like, what's going on here? It took us digging into the paper that NCBI record was published from and finding that actual record was passaged through Vero cells, green monkey kidney cells, 10 times. And that was enough to flip the confirmation of that genome to the human perspective of the model. You can imagine that's a small example of what you might run into if you train on really poorly annotated
Great.
Public data. So that's a barrier to entry to bad actors, because most of the elbow grease in doing this is not releasing the AI model, it's the feature engineering and the proper metadata labeling. So that's a great barrier to entry to bad actors. It's also a barrier to entry to the more benign and useful.
Great, very thoughtful question. Yeah, reactions to that. Yeah, curation of data, the messiness of data, inaccuracies.
Great question. Completely agree with that sentiment in terms of making. First off, we want to acknowledge that things like AlphaFold wouldn't have happened if the PDB didn't exist. And the other thing that you point to, that it's harder in biology. I think Michelle was talking about how hard it is, and I can tell you, coming from engineering, that biology was frustrating because you do exactly the same thing, and then still the result is different. That variability is a huge challenge. And I think that's why I'm thinking that there is going to be an increasing pace of innovation and performance in the future, because we're not going to just rely on historical data that is messy, but there is going to be new data generation as well that people will take better care for annotating, for better metadata, right, as well as standardization that will then train a next generation of models, particularly BDTs. So I agree that that's the front end. If you want to think about this as a system, you want to secure the data, you want to secure the AI model, you want to then secure when it translates into the physical realm. Stay tuned.
Go ahead, Michelle.
Yeah, let me just quickly add that it's one of the concepts that we're shaping in our idea toolbox for the AI BioKit. So we'd love to chat more with you or with the team on your thoughts there. But one of the questions we're asking researchers are, what are other types of big data sets? Shankar mentioned the PDB. What are other types of biological data sets that would be helpful if the government were to support the creation, curation, and standardization of more of those types of big open data sets? We've heard about sequencing microbes that exist in the US and globally as a way to build out sequence databases. We've heard about not just protein structure, but would RNA structure databases be useful for new types of therapeutics and tools? So that's one of the questions we're asking and hoping to get input from the community on what types of data sets would be most helpful to drive the type of capabilities you're discussing.
Thanks, Michelle. Let me invite a question or a comment.
Hey there, good evening. My name is Lee Cotton from Congressman Winstrup's office. I'm his National Security Advisor. Dr. Rozo, great to see you again, and thank you all for being a part of this discussion. My question deals more, I think, from the IC side, the sensitive fence, so to speak. Over time, we've seen our adversaries copy or replicate our advanced weapon systems, drones, academic research that then gets moved into classified spaces for those adversaries, and more. So I guess from a CI standpoint, how do we better protect our advances in AI-driven biotechnology and biosecurity, the ones we do for ourselves and the ones we do in partnership with our or with our allies and partners against our adversaries? Because it seems like, you know, the renewed axis of evil is very good at entering each space that we seem to advance in and finding ways to copy or pull out parts that they would like to then use to build their own types of systems, whether it's China, Russia, you name it. So thank you.
Thanks for the question. A hard question, important question. Any reactions to that in this very open field that we work in biology? Yeah.
So, you know, I'll say that I think that is a serious concern and a focus and a priority for this administration as well. And if you look at the series of executive orders and the actions that have been taking place, either from the Bioeconomy and Biomanufacturing Act to the AI executive order, and then stay tuned for other EOs that will come up shortly, making sure that we are able to protect our open ecosystem from being misused or misappropriated is a strong priority, but it's a hard problem. It's not easy, and that's where we want to kind of engage, first of all, you know, with all the private sector, as well as academia and other departments and agencies, but also hoping to work with Congress to kind of find the right solutions that balance these competing needs.
I just add, you know, as someone who worked on research security for a number of years, this is something that I think is a real, it's a really hard problem set, because the same things that you need in the open to inform innovation and drive further, faster, first, right? I think, like to Michelle's point earlier, I think the key here is that we need to get there first, and do it in a way that respects our values, that's in line with our principles. And we need to do that bringing alongside this broader innovation ecosystem, while also knowing that some of these things will also potentially be leaked or, you know, diverted. And so, it's hard. I don't have a solution for you, but I do think that one important piece to remember and recognize is that it is important to have a capability. I think at DOE, we firmly believe that it's important that we can see both sides of the line, and that there's a place to do that in a way that, you know, is informed by the intelligence. And, you know, I think that there's a component of the DOE is part of the IC. And I think that really helps inform some of the work that we do and what we decide to release out in the open and what we keep behind.
Yeah, and I would just add that your question is so important as we think about, even though I think it's right, of course, to say that designs that are in silico are not the same thing as physical manifestations in a laboratory. But then if we make in silico designs, they move them into the outside world, they don't stay within a particular lab or a company, they're available for the rest of the world to do with what they want. So I think we might have some, I think we shouldn't have false solace in the fact that something's only a design. If it's a design and it's out in the world, then we have to think about what else will happen with it once it's out in the world in the wild. But hard problem. Megan.
Thanks. Megan Palmer, I'm Senior Director of Public Impact at Ginkgo Bioworks and an Adjunct Professor of Bioengineering at Stanford, and it's been a great discussion. You've spoken about the need to have a great amount of agility with a rapidly developing field that we can't fully foresee. And it's been great to see the number of different efforts that are being championed within government, also within private industry. I'm curious, are there models that inspire you around those types of leadership fora that are actually able to capture the right players? Are there principles around such fora on what they should or should not do? And then critically, is there a type of enabling role of the government in particular to be able to foster this type of private consortia, or is this demanding something new?
Megan, would you just say one more thing about that? When you said these kind of four, you mean public, private consortia on these particular challenges?
Yeah, what I mean is that there's the idea that we don't want to hard code too much in a field that we don't know that much, that poorly designed policies itself could have other types of unintended consequences, and we're sort of grasping at what the right mechanisms are. And so sort of leadership fora, as have existed with other types of tools, are a way to sort of make sure that those industry leaders are involved and can keep abreast. But how do we keep them accountable with the right players and with the right measures?
Got it. Any analogs or precedents that come to mind in terms of this moment that we're in with AI and bio that would be useful kind of to get to Megan's really good question? How do we form the partnership between government, commission, industry, researchers?
I mean, this is not a bio analog. This is more of an AI adjacent analog, but I think really applies in this space. One thing that I think we think about when we think about the space is our work in the exascale computing program, which is really, I mean, I think if we think about really successful mission-driven partnership with industry, which has had really wide-ranging impacts, it really has been that. You know, our role in the government was setting very aggressive standards for performance and efficiency of chips that, you know, we would be using in our supercomputers, and working with industry to co-design and co-develop what has, you know, that ended up becoming critical components to NVIDIA's GPUs. I think the other part of this is, you know, the government's role in fostering competition in this space. And I would flag that, you know, for our flagship machines in Frontier, Aurora, El Capitan that is coming online, they're all flagship machines for different companies. And that's a unique role that only the government can play in this space.
Michelle, I saw you, or Shankar.
So great question. And the honest answer is I've been struggling and thinking about this, and nothing really comes to mind as an ideal fit. That is, you know, always, you can say, if you look at existential risk and you think nuclear, but, you know, we don't have a nuclear reactor in our garage, hopefully not, at least, right? And so, and the fact that in this one, it's the rapidity of technological change that is a huge concern, and that happened only in the last decade. So the only thing that I can even think that is remotely close in terms of the pace of development was thinking back when the internet came, and we need to kind of think about how to regulate commerce, regulate communication, all of that. But even that, I think, is a pale comparison to this, given the amount of harm or benefit that this can do. So, Megan, I don't have a great answer, but the other thing that I wanted to mention is, as the EO tasks our Department of Commerce colleagues to set up the AI Safety Institute, it is anticipated that that will be a principal storefront in which they are engaging the private partners as well as academics in there as we advance the safety science in this. So looking forward to that.
Just two comments on top of that, because I agree with Helena and Shankar that it's a hard question. And Shankar mentioned the internet. And I think there's some lessons learned there where we saw, you know, cybersecurity best practices and tools being tacked on after the development. We had to come up with solutions for problems for commerce and regulation after, you know, the internet was developed. We are at a different moment now, as we've talked about earlier. Some of the risks that we are worried about with the AI and bioconvergence, you know, we're not seeing them yet, right? We are at left of boom. We have the ability to address some of these issues now before this unknown potential to develop a threat that we, you know, are not prepared for. And so I don't have an answer to the question except to say that it is an opportunity for us and forum like these to start to shape these concepts for what could be nimble and address some of the risks, you know, before we start to see them develop.
Tejal, as someone who's in the industry, what do you see as being useful to you from the government side or from the civil society side?
These are very hard questions. I will say some of the funding for research and like increased diversity of folks doing red teaming and evaluations from all aspects of society is something.
Not good was the last two words. Okay. Yeah, I mean, and Megan, I would just say that in a meeting that we had with government and some of the LLMs back in November, what we observed was that there were very different views on what the problems were, very different views about what government was most concerned about. And so it definitely reinforced for us the importance of a tight connection, because industry was asking very pointed questions about what is it that you're most worried about so that we can focus our worries appropriately as well. So great question. Michelle, time for two more questions.
Okay. Hi, I'm Meg Resch from Griffin Scientific. I wanted to bring the conversation back to what my colleague from MRI was talking about with data. As someone who's been deeply involved with the influenza community for the past decade in organizing and getting their data out into the broader community, I would say there's a lot more challenges there that need to be thought about in terms, because the folks who are generating this data are not the same groups that are going to be using it to model and to put into an AI. And it's really expensive to standardize data across a research consortium, and difficult to decide what level of granularity you would like. So the level of granularity that would have been helpful in this case is pretty deep, like knowing the number of passages of cells through after it had originally been isolated. So there's a cost benefit that has to be weighed, and there's probably an opportunity to try to bring together those two communities, the modelers and the actual folks collecting the data, to understand, but it's going to be a big investment that's going to need to happen for that to actually move forward. The other point I wanted to make was around private data. So there's really rich repositories of private data in corporations and tools like SciFinder at pharmaceutical companies, and a lot of the safety evaluations that we're performing are using tools that have open data. And once you put in these large repositories, I think it's really going to change the security profile and risks, because there's things that we're not going to be able to anticipate might come together out of those sets. Thank you.
Thanks, Mike. We'll take one last question and then, or comment, and then we'll have a chance for closing thoughts here.
Hi, Christine Farquharson, CSL Seqirus. It's a flu vaccine manufacturer. I wanted to ask a question actually based on my experience in a previous life when I worked in OMB's health division on a lot of regulation development. And so as you talk today about how do you make regulations that are future focused and flexible and almost evergreen, I wonder if in your conversations in the interagency or elsewhere, you're discussing whether you need flexibilities under the Administrative Procedures Act or other ways in which economically significant rules must pass muster. For example, how do you qualify costs and benefits? And you know, there are established norms in that space, but maybe given the this is just a hypothetical here, the speed at which things are evolving and you need to push things out, maybe you need flexibilities, or maybe you need to do a combination of regulation that can be rolled out more quickly and sub-regulatory guidance. So anyway, just some thoughts.
Very sophisticated OMB question.
I take that as a volunteer, so.
And let me just add one more comment to the mix, and then I want to get a final comment from everyone, then we'll close. Some have said, not in this room per se, but some have said that it's having world-leading innovation and kind of leading efforts at risk mitigation are kind of mutually exclusive. But let me ask, is a better analogy that we could be as we are, I think we could say, in the medicine development world, where we have the world's leading engine for creating new medicines and vaccines, but we also have the FDA, which is the world's leading agency in thinking through how to make safe and effective products. Could we get to that place? Do you think they're mutually exclusive? So just thinking about the last comments that were made, or anything else you'd like to say to those in the room working on these issues on the Hill in particular, or more broadly. Let's just go down the line and then we'll conclude.
Great. Well, I think for us, I talked a lot about the open and close and both sides of the fence, and I think to some extent we're really concerned with how do we do R&D in a way where the risk is minimized, right? And then how do you develop improved capabilities for minimizing that risk? I mean, essentially, these are two sides of the same coin. They're both things that we believe that there is capability at the labs to do that. We want to bring that to bear for our interagency colleagues, for the AI Safety Institute and consortia. and partnering with our allies and partners, just really getting to grips with this in as fast of a way as possible. But you know, this is the beginning of this challenge. We are all on this journey together. The AI executive order implementation continues. But I think these things will be enduring. These questions will be enduring, and the need for this kind of capability will be enduring.
Thanks so much. Shankar.
I think given, as I said, we've all talked about how the future is unpredictable and changing really fast, and the best way is not to be reactive but to be proactive, which means, you know, we need tools and techniques that are born safe, if you want to use that word. And given the pace at which things are evolving, that means there is not much time. We need to kind of act with a sense of urgency, and this is across the whole of society. Government has a part, and private sector has a part, think tanks and academics have a part, as well as, you know, just evolving and developing a sense, a culture of safety as inborn in these tools and approaches. So I think looking forward to kind of engaging in that particular journey.
Great, thanks so much. Michelle.
Yeah, we'll just say, you know, I was grateful to be able to share some of the work that we are undertaking at the Commission. Again, would just encourage everyone to check out our policy papers and concepts. And, you know, we touched on many ideas that align with many of the questions, many of the discussion themes today, of how we could come up with recommendations that balance the opportunities that we see with AI and bio, and also mitigate against the risks. And so there's plenty of great perspectives in this community, in this room, that can bring insights from industry, from former government officials that may know about unique regulatory opportunities. We'd love to hear about that. So please, you know, come find me, come find the staff, or check us out at biotech.senate.gov.
Thanks so much. Tejal and OpenAI.
This has been great. It's been great learning from all of you as well. I just want to say we're very eager to chat with folks in the community where we feel that we sort of understand from an AI perspective how to test our models for both the good and the bad, but it's very important to partner with domain experts who really understand the threat models themselves, have really been on the ground, and so please talk to us. We want to work with you on our research and our evals and hope that AGI is safe and beneficial for humanity.
Great. Well, with that positive ending, I think we'll bring this to a close. And please join me in thanking our incredible leaders and panelists.